On Crime Watch, the jewel thieves who turned Halloween into a nightmare. Tonight, we need names. And welcome to Crime Watch. We're live, and I'm surrounded by some of the UK's most senior detectives, all hoping that your call will be the one to help solve a major crime. Coming up, the have-a-go hero stabbed for stepping in. Here's what happened.
And as well as some of the UK's most wanted, I'm after a guy caught on camera in a public toilet. Take a look at this. The offender loiters outside the cubicles. He then attacks a pensioner, grabbing him by the basins. He steals just a few quid and leaves his elderly victim on the floor. Unbelievable. But who is he? Tonight we need your help to flush him out.
And we have the story of how police caught the killer who fooled the outside world into thinking his victim was still alive. As she lay dead at home, he even paid her bills to throw people off the trail. He was caught thanks to a note left for the milkman and a call to Crime Watch.
But first, the gang who turned Halloween into a nightmare. Four men approached a jeweller's front door, but this was no trick or treat. They were armed with one of these. A sledgehammer. They used it to break in. A lot of people saw what happened, and someone out there will know who did this. Watch closely, and if you can help us, call us.
My family have been jewellers since 1924. I wasn't really interested in joining the business at all. And then I was a national serviceman when I came back out of the army. And my father said, well, you better come and work for me for a while and get some money together. In the following 2 months, I fell in love with the jewellery business. And it's obviously in the blood. I decided to open a jewellery shop in Chobham with my wife, Sandy. We invested most of our life savings in the business, and I was anxious that my children should learn the trade as well. 4 months ago, tragically, my eldest daughter died during the night, and we were devastated, obviously. And frankly, we didn't think things could get much worse than that. And now we have this situation on our hands, which it beggars belief, basically.
My colleague and I opened the shop at 9 o'clock as per normal and put all the jewellery out, which normally takes about 1 hour. We're always aware of security, and our particular shop, we have a buzzer on the door so that people have to knock before we allow them in. I noticed a car had driven up right on the pavement, right outside the front door, and immediately knew that something was wrong.
Oh, my God.
And my assistant said, oh, my God, Sandy, come on, we've got to go, we've got to go, and grab me. I managed to grab the shop keys and thought I'd try and lock the back door so that they couldn't come after us.
Hang up.
I felt absolutely petrified. I just couldn't move and I couldn't think straight. I felt claustrophobic because I didn't think there was any way out of our backyard. So I cowered on the floor. And Sandra then had gone to the back fence and was calling out, help, help.
Please, anybody.
And help came and they got us through.
Yeah. I was driving down Chobham High Street. I was looking around, just waiting for the traffic to move on, and suddenly a man came running out from the jeweller's. I locked myself into the car. He seemed to disappear into a car that was parked. Just a few moments later, three more large, well-built men ran really fast across the road and disappeared into the car, and then the car sped off. It was just shocking. That's the best word I can use to describe it.
I was driving along the Lightwater bypass and I saw a car coming out of Black Stroud Lane and cross the dual carriageway across the grass bank at some speed. Slowed right down on the inside lane and then sped up and headed towards the M3 motorway.
This burglary, which has destroyed a lot of our business and also the confidence of the people who work with us, it's just beyond belief, beyond comprehension.
Very traumatic for that small family business. I'm joined now by DS Rob Bryant. Thanks for taking the time to join us. A lot of money involved here, £350,000 worth of jewellery taken from this very small family-run store. Take us through some of the stuff that was stolen.
Mostly what was stolen was diamond rings. As you can see, the small one was £17,500. And the larger one was £25,000.
Okay, so it's very high-end jewellery we're talking about here.
That's correct.
You're linking this to another robbery that happened somewhere in Surrey?
That's correct, yes. On the 18th of August, in a jewellery shop in Chobham, three men burst in, we believe, using the same sledgehammer and using a getaway vehicle also purchased in the West Sussex area.
Right. Now, the lady in her car, one of the witnesses, said, you know, they were big blokes. Apart from big blokes, what else can you tell us about them?
As you can see from the CCTV, they're all wearing balaclavas, but they're also, their clothing is very distinctive. There was one male wearing a stripy top and another male wearing brown shoes.
Now, tell me about, there were two cars we saw there in the film. What do you need to know about them and what do you know so far?
We know the black Vauxhall Amiga was bought in the West Sussex area about 4 months prior to the robbery. What we need to know is where it's been beforehand.
Right, so for quite a few months it's been stored somewhere.
That's correct, stored somewhere, but we need to know exactly where that is.
And then there was the blue Volvo as well.
Yes, the blue Volvo estate is something we really do need to know about. When they ran to that getaway vehicle, they drove it across a dual carriageway across the central reservation, which is a dangerous manoeuvre to undertake. And they then drove at speed down the A322, the Lightwater bypass.
Is there anything else that you want to appeal for specifically tonight for information?
We believe that the jewellery is very distinctive and they haven't yet managed to sell this on, so we're asking for anybody who may have been approached in strange or suspicious circumstances to call us regarding anyone trying to sell this jewellery.
Okay, thanks very much for now. There's lots to go on there, so if you can help, please do call us. The number's right there on the screen. You could call also the independent charity Crime Stoppers anonymously. Let me give you that number. It's 0800 555 111. If you need to see our reconstruction again, it's at bbc.co.uk/crimewatch. Now, here's Rav with some villains caught in the act on camera.
Back in January, we showed you this. Four youths robbing commuters at London stations. Here they grab a laptop. The owner ends up on the floor. Straight after our appeal, police got the names they were after. All four have now been sentenced to a total of 23 years. As this programme has proved, CCTV cameras are everywhere these days. Even public toilets don't escape their BDI. Take a look at this. It's rush hour at the Gents in Elephant and Castle, and this elderly man is waiting for a cubicle. Eventually, he's in luck, but that luck is about to run out. Keep your eye on the man washing his hands. Having used his shirt as a towel, he starts shouting and banging on the cubicle door. What's his problem? He spends ages pacing around, ranting and raving. The man trapped inside can't hide all day. When he comes out, the suspect moves in. Someone tries to help and our victim gets to smell fresh air, but not for long. He's grabbed by the basins and the attacker lunges for his pockets. He falls. The robber takes his money and leaves him lying on the floor. Staking out a public lav for a few quid, you can't get much lower than that. If you know him, it's time to flush him out. A news agent's in Camberwell, London, early Sunday morning in August, and the shop assistant is stacking shelves. A customer enters and walks around, only stopping to ask for a packet of fags. Then, out of the blue, he gets out a metal baton and starts beating the assistant, hitting him around the head 5 or 6 times. He stops when the victim shouts for help. A totally unprovoked attack. Know him, shop him. People are not always what they seem. Take this bloke, buying building supplies from this store in Grimsby in May. He looks like a genuine punter, but police believe he's involved in a series of scams on builders' merchants across the country. He uses false names and fake company orders to pay for the goods and then disappears without a trace. Not so clever anymore. Distinctive England t-shirt, dodgy tash and goatee. Name, please. The man standing by the door at this bookies in East London is the lookout for a gang of robbers. While he checks that the coast is clear, his mates smash open a games machine and steal the cash. The lookout is doing a very good job of giving us a good look at him. A little bit closer? Yeah, that's better. Another day, another robbery, and another lookout. This one seems to be a bit more careful about his appearance. Oops, not for long. They could be with this man, Junior McGibbon, who's also thought to be part of this gang. If you've seen any of them, it's time to call us. Who is this man? Police believe he could be a key witness and have vital information in a child sex abuse investigation. They urgently need to trace him. Here he is in Asda at 6:30 a.m. doing his shopping. Look at the jacket, look at the face. If you recognise him, tell us who he is. If this is you, we need you to call. Think you recognise anyone? Well, call us here in the studio. The number's there on your screen. Or you can text us on 63399. Just type crime, space and any message. It's important to leave that space or your message won't get through.
Now, if you need a second look at tonight's CCTV, it's online, bbc.co.uk/crimewatch. Still ahead, the mystery of what happened to this woman here, Irma Tati Rogers. A year ago, she vanished without trace. Police now think it's murder. Her friend Deviani joins me here in the studio to make a special appeal.
And I've been to Merseyside on the trail of an armed robber who stabbed a man.
And all I could think of at the time was, if I kick him, he might release the security guard. At that point, I saw in his right hand he had a long-bladed chef's knife. I put my hands on the side and realised I'd been stabbed. I was extremely lucky in so much as, although the wound was penetrated over 8 inches, the knife missed every major organ.
And this is David Munley. He's a psychopath. Later we'll have the story of how he murdered a pensioner and then went to extraordinary lengths to fool the outside world into thinking she was still alive. He very nearly got away with it, but was caught out by his own handwriting left on a note to the milkman.
But for our next case, we go to Egham in Surrey. The victim, a young woman on her way home from work. She is subjected to a violent sexual assault. Had it not been for her incredible strength of character, and it has to be said, very quick thinking, the outcome, well, it could have been far worse. The woman has very bravely agreed to talk us through the events of that night. Here's what happened.
Oh, trees.
time.
Beautiful.
We are looking for two men, both of whom have been drinking, probably in one of the local pubs, watching the Arsenal and Hull match.
When I came out of the station, I pretty much knew I was going to go the back way, which I had been once before, but it was daytime, and so I didn't think that I would possibly get lost when it was dark.
All right, go, Jess!
Well, she's beautiful, ain't she?
I'd been working a long shift. I wasn't feeling very well. I was very tired, so I just thought, well, I'll avoid any possible trouble and just cross the road and carry on walking the way I thought I knew.
Had a good night, have you?
We're not going to stop and talk to us.
My iPod had died on the train, but I just put in my headphones so it looked like I was listening to something, just so I didn't have to really engage with them, and I just carried on walking. The girls in front of me, I presume they were students. I was sort of following them because I didn't really know where I was going. But then I think when they turned off, something was telling me that the university wasn't that way and it was the way I went. I went through the cut-through, I turned around and realised the guys weren't there. After a few minutes, I started sort of hearing sort of leaves and things crunching, but I thought that it was just the wind.
We believe the two men came from the shortcut down to this level crossing where they caught sight of the girl.
I saw the gym gates. I mean, I know where the gym is on campus, so I knew exactly how to get from there to where I wanted to go, which was the front gates. When I realised they were shut, I was a bit unnerved. All I thought was, I know exactly where I'm going now. I'm not far from home. I'll be fine.
Give a shit.
Our victim suffered a terrifying ordeal. She was seriously and violently sexually assaulted. We must find the two men that did this to her.
Emotionally, it's affected me quite badly. And I've always been quite a strong person, so I think that, I mean, some people it probably would affect a lot worse than it's affected me. But I block things out, and I think that's probably what I'll do with this as well.
A horrific thing to go through. I'm joined by DI Brendan Collins. Evening, Brendan. She was very brave, this young woman, and in fact things could have been much worse.
Yes, and if it wasn't for the courage that she showed by fighting off her attackers, it could have been a lot worse.
Yeah, she was a great strength of character. In the reconstruction, we saw in front of her these two girls who may actually, up until tonight, have no idea at all of anything that went on behind them. They're significant.
Yes, these two young ladies could prove to be very important and significant witnesses, but unlikely to be unaware of that fact. So if they're watching tonight, I would urge them to make contact with us.
So what are they witnesses to, just to get home the seriousness of this?
Yes, it's likely they've been walking in front of everything that's been going on from the railway station up to the point they went over the footpath. They are blonde, they're in their 20s, and because of the route they took, we believe they could have been on the way to the halls of residence at the university.
OK, so maybe young women with something to do with that university.
Yes.
In one way or another. Right, these two guys, the two attackers, tell me what we know about them.
It's highly probable they'd been drinking locally that evening. In fact, may have been watching the Arsenal Hull match, which was a 5:30 kickoff. Both are in their 20s, both are white, One of the men is about 6 foot of a slim build, and he was wearing a dark coloured hoodie, which is zipped up the front, and wearing jeans. The second guy is probably a little bit taller and of a bigger build, and he's also wearing a hoodie, but with a black jumper over the top, and again, is wearing jeans.
OK, now, this young woman, not just brave, but a quick thinker. She stubbed out a cigarette. Where was it? And it would have... I mean, that would have left a mark.
Yeah, during the attack, she stubbed a cigarette out on the right forearm of one of her attackers. Now, it's highly unlikely that the wound will still be visible now, but at the time, and for a few days afterwards, it probably would have been. So, with the burn and the descriptions, we'd like to hear anyone that can put those two together.
And what about forensics? Anything significant there?
Yes, we do have some DNA profiles, which we can use to help eliminate anyone from the investigation.
I mean, that's vital, actually, because people are thinking, I don't want to make the call. They can make the call, and people could be counted out if it's not them. Brennan, for now, thanks very much. If you can help, call or text us now. The numbers are right there on the screen. If you've been a victim of crime, there is the victim support line. They are on 0845 30 30 900. Now here's Rav with some of the UK's most wanted.
And I've got some right turkeys here, so let's see if we can ruin their Christmas. First up is Carl Cronin. He's wanted in connection with large-scale property fraud in London and Surrey. He's got as many as 11 aliases, including James Moore, Jonathan Carson and Andrew Tapper. Number two is Hafisa Rahman, and he's wanted for a burglary on a flat in Bethnal Green. Now, he was charged but didn't turn up in court, and he's now on the run. He's 25 and has previously worked as a waiter in Indian restaurants. Damien Rotney is my number three. He was charged with GBH on a police officer in Wolverhampton. He skipped bail and hasn't been seen since. Ron is 23 and originally from Poland. And number four is Dapo Famarotti, and he's wanted in connection with the rape of a six-year-old girl. Famarotti is 31, originally from Nigeria, and has connections to Plumstead in South London. So if you can help, don't wait, phone or text now. The number's there on your screen, and these mugshots are also online, bbc.co.uk/crimewatch.
And the phones are hotting up already. A number of good calls on that sledgehammer raid in Chobham in Surrey. Someone who believes that they might have seen all that jewellery, £350,000 worth, you'll remember. We've also had some good calls, sightings on that elephant and castle toilet attack. Now, a while back, Crimewatch paid a visit to the Matrix team, a pioneering unit set up by Merseyside police to tackle armed raids on security vans used to transport sums of cash. They've had a lot of success in reducing these so-called cash and transit robberies, but tonight they do need your help to catch some of the more elusive offenders. Rab's been to find out more.
This is Operation Matrix in action, in the war against robbers who target cash in transit. I'm in Merseyside, home of the Matrix unit. They've got a lot of jobs on and they need your help. So how's the project gone then?
Excellent. Prior to Matrix being set up, we're experiencing on some occasions between one and two robberies per day. That's now down to probably only one or two a month, which is a significant reduction.
Massive reduction. Yeah. So how have you actually gone about doing that?
We utilise marked police vehicles and unmarked police vehicles to follow cash deliveries. And that's been a great deterrent.
To send out a sort of warning signal.
Certainly, yeah.
So I know from experience that investigating these robberies isn't without its challenges, is it?
No. We treat this as a very serious crime. There are victims, and on occasions there is a lot of violence and sometimes injury caused to people. We're keen for people to come forward and tell us about who's committing these type of offences.
And obviously then there's the money element. I mean, it's hardly going to good causes, isn't it?
Not at all, no. I would suggest that the money goes towards organised crime.
It's going straight back in the criminal underworld. Now, you've got some people here that you really, really want to track down and you're having some difficulty with. I recognise this guy straight away as we had him on the programme.
We're very keen to trace him.
Ago.
This guy's called Russell Grant. He's wanted for an offence in Merseyside. This guy here, Warren Mortimer, we're also interested to trace him.
And who's this guy?
This guy is called John Mulhall.
And who have we got over here?
These two here. Yeah, these two guys, we believe these are working together, Ryan Lamb and Lee Donachie. Very keen to trace both of those two.
Now, there's another case that you really need some help on, isn't it? A pretty brutal
right, yeah.
one. What can you tell me about that?
This is the one that we urgently need to trace. This guy came within inches of murdering somebody.
Let's have a look.
That afternoon, I was en route to a business meeting and realised I needed to go and cash a cheque.
I called into Lloyd's TSB. I went into the bank just after 1 o'clock, 1:10, something like that, and there was absolutely nobody in the bank apart from the staff. Walked to the part in the centre of the bank where you can make your cheques out and write your deposit slips. Did the paperwork, went up to the counter.
The van's here!
I remember that day. I came up to Lloyd's Bank and I thought I'd do it just before my lunch. I had a quick look around and left the van. Walked to the front door of the bank, had a look inside, just seemed to be one customer in the bank.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Could I cash this cheque, please?
Yes,
hiya, love.
Hi, you all right?
Just the one today.
Just the one, that's lovely.
Yeah, great stuff.
At the corner of my eye, I saw somebody coming towards me.
Yes, yeah, it's nice.
Within 2 seconds, I found myself being thrown against the counter and on the floor. It was a frenzied attack. The knife was coming at me, a 12-inch kitchen knife. You just grab it. You don't have an option to think about it. If I would have thought about it, I would have been seriously stabbed.
Give me the money!
It became obvious that the security guard was in trouble. I got my mobile phone out trying to summon help by dialing 999, but I just couldn't press the right keys on the keypad. My hands were shaking too much.
I've got a knife!
And all I could think of at the time was, if I kick him, he might release the security guard, and we might be able, between the two of us, to subdue him until the police arrived.
Look.
At that point, I saw in his right hand, he had a long-bladed chef's knife.
You're gonna get stabbed. You're gonna get stabbed!
As he ran towards me, he lunged across and struck me just above the left hip. I was aware of a warm, wet feeling on my stomach. I put my hands to my side and realised I'd been stabbed. In terms of the stab wound, I was extremely lucky in so much as, although the wound was penetrated over 8 inches, the knife missed the liver, kidneys, spleen, every major organ, but also missed the main blood supply in that part of the body by less than 5 millimetres.
It was just a frenzied attack with no care for human life. He got away. But, like, if he's not caught, he is going to kill somebody next time.
He's clearly such a violent individual, isn't he? Could have been so much more serious.
It could have been a lot more serious. The victim who was stabbed had to have emergency surgery.
Now, despite his attempted disguise, you've got some pretty good clues to go on, haven't you?
That's right, yes. This coat is of particular interest. We actually found it quite difficult to find one for the reconstruction, so that could be significant. And if anybody remembers a coat like this, that could be particularly useful to us.
Very much so. Now, he had the black hat, didn't he? And you believe he had a stocking over his face?
That's right, which has obviously distorted his image a little bit.
And one thing that we can see from the image, actually, he's got quite a distinctive nose, hasn't he?
Yes, and we've got a further description of him. We believe he's between 35 and 45 years of age, around about 6 foot tall, and he's described as having a local accent, but of particular note, he's described as being quite well-spoken.
And then, of course, there's this horrendous-looking knife, and we believe it was something like this that was used.
That's right, yes.
It's a miracle that no-one was killed.
I know.
Well, with all those clues, you've got some pretty good stuff to go on. I think he's got quite a distinctive face and you've got some really good quality stills here. Someone must know who he is.
Well, lots of strong clues, as Rav says. There's now a £100,000 reward for information leading to arrest and conviction. Let me just remind you of the other suspects featured in that film, all wanted by the Matrix coppers. First up, there is Russell Grant. He's still on the run despite our appeal for him last month. He's wanted for a cash and transit robbery. There is now a 30 grand reward on this man's head. Warren Mortimer, he's wanted for theft in Cheshire. And John Mulhall, he's wanted for a cash and transit robbery in December of last year. Next, we saw Ryan Lamb and Lee Donaghy. There's a substantial reward on these two for information leading to arrests and conviction. Do you know where they're hiding tonight? Call us here in the studio, or you could call the instant room in Merseyside Direct, 0151 777 5810. Now, with developments on recent Crimewatch cases, here's Matthew.
Well, now to a case that's been in the news over the last few weeks. It's the murder 5 years ago of 17-year-old Hannah Foster. Well, at the time, we reconstructed her last movements and spoke to her parents.
Hannah was always a very happy person, one of those sort of children with a ready smile. And she's just, you know, that expression people say about flourishing into a young woman, that was what we were witnessing. It's just the sort of girl that you just always felt very proud of.
Hannah had gone out for the night with a friend in Southampton. They stayed for one drink before moving on to another bar. At around 10:30, they called it a night and started to make their way home. CCTV picks them up, heading for the bus stop. Hannah saw her friend onto the bus before heading off. It was the last time she was seen alive. Hannah never made it home. Her body was found 2 days later, dumped by a roadside. She'd been raped and strangled.
On being told, I think I immediately said, I need to see her. But something reassuring must have been said to me to make me think this is definitely Hannah they found.
I think it's really the people around us, the friends and the community and the police help that we've had that have pulled us through and given us that strength we need.
Well, someone watching our appeal that night pieced the clues together and realised the killer actually worked for him. He called in and named Maninda Pal Singh Kohli, a sandwich delivery driver from Southampton. Well, within hours, Kohli was the prime suspect, but he'd already fled to India. It took 3 years to bring him back to the UK to face trial, and last month he was found guilty of kidnap, rape and murder and sentenced to life. Proof that just one call to Crimewatch really can make all the difference.
It really does. Now, some more good news on a CCTV case from last year. Remember this?
A field in Essex, August bank holiday last year, and police are called to close down an illegal rave when all hell breaks loose. A hardcore group are intent on violence. They smash up cars and start throwing missiles. Fearing for their lives, officers are forced to call for backup as things get worse. Dozens of them are injured and taken to hospital with broken bones and head injuries.
It was a shocking attack on police officers, and we asked for your help to find those responsible. You didn't let us down and you called in with their names. As a result, 10 people were arrested and charged. They all pleaded guilty to violent disorder and were sentenced to a total of 8 years between them.
Now, one of our most wanted faces last month was this man, Simon Firby. He was found guilty of an armed robbery at an off-licence in 2006, but failed to turn up at court and then went on the run. Less than 24 hours after our appeal, and as a direct result of your calls, police arrested Firby in Hull. He's now in custody and will be sentenced in the new year.
Well, let's just hope we get a result like that in our next case. Ricardo Cox was a 20-year-old student, big Arsenal fan. Just over 2 weeks ago, he popped out to his local KFC with his brother O'Neill in Croydon in South London. As they were walking back home, Ricardo was gunned down in a drive-by shooting. He was shot twice. He died later on in hospital. Joining me is DCI Damien Alley. Thanks for taking the time to join us. Why was this young man, Ricardo, killed?
Ricardo was a really decent young man. He was a member of the Air Training Corps in Croydon. Totally wrong place, wrong time. We think he was gunned down in response to a gang feud in the area, but we're working on the basis it was mistaken identity, an absolute tragedy.
That is a complete tragedy. Just a young boy getting on with his life. We've got CCTV footage that you've given us of the minutes, the sort of last 20 minutes, half hour, leading up to his life. Tell us what we're looking at here.
This is about 9 o'clock on the evening of the murder. Ricardo's with his brother in the KFC in the West Croydon area. Here they are leaving. And they're going towards Derby Road in Croydon.
OK, so they're walking... which street is this?
This is Derby Road.
This is Derby Road.
This is literally the last moments of Ricardo's life.
What we can't see there, then, is the car coming towards them and pulling up. Let's take a look in other footage that you've got of this car.
This is a Honda car, DG56 XTR. It was stolen on the 8th of October in the Tulse Hill area and had been seen on a number of occasions involved in possible criminality, doing recces and dry runs of cash and transit deliveries in the area.
OK, let's also take a look. We've got some interesting footage. Tell me, is this is them sort of trying to torch the car, is it? They're trying to get rid of evidence here. What are we seeing?
This is on the 1st of December in Peel Road, just off Thornton Road, near to Croydon Crematorium, Croydon Cemetery. They've set light to the car, tried to set light to it, but we've recovered it virtually intact and conducting forensic tests at the moment.
Well, that's good news. Damien, tell me what you know about the men you'd like to speak to.
We know that car had been in circulation in and around the Croydon and Lambeth areas since its theft. We'd like to speak to anyone that may have any information about the occupants, and we're also keen to recover a firearm, an unusual .22 pistol that was used in this offence.
OK, what about these blokes? Because we've got some film of the men you're interested in elsewhere.
OK, we've got some footage here which is taken on the 30th of October at Mayday Hospital when four suspects in the vehicle were seen in the car park at about 10 in the morning. They were doing a dry run, possibly a recce of a robbery, and they followed the guard into the reception area of Mayday Hospital.
Okay,
and for whatever reason, they didn't go ahead with the robbery.
So quite a distinctive group there of four guys all together. There's one guy who you're also interested in.
Yeah, this is on the night before the murder, about 10 o'clock in Streatham Place McDonald's in Tulse Hill. We think that this individual has important information for us. We'd urge him to come forward or anyone who knows him to speak to us.
OK, Damien, thanks very much for that. We do really need to catch whoever did this. Dangerous people, call us here in the studio if you can help. The number 0500 600 600, or you could call the independent charity Crime Stoppers anonymously, 0800 555 111. Now, here's Rav with more Faces in the Frame.
And it would really make my Christmas to get this off the streets. Right, number five is Vadim's Holostova. Police want to speak to him about the rape and serious assault of a woman in Duke Street Cemetery, Southport in Merseyside on Thursday the 20th of November. 6'2", originally from Latvia and may have connections in Edinburgh. Six is Dean Dixon. He's wanted for possession of more than 200,000 ecstasy tablets. Dixon hasn't been seen since avoiding arrest in May. He has links to Tufnell Park and King's Cross in London and also Dundee and Edinburgh. Seven is Leary Sterling. He's also wanted for drugs offences in South Yorkshire. He was arrested and bailed but hasn't been seen since. He's 44 years old and may also be known as Lee Cunningham and uses the street name Leroy. And last but by no means least is Ben Murphy. He's wanted in connection with a robbery at a jewellery store in Sheffield. Now, he's originally from Manchester and has connections to Sale and Withenshaw. He's got several tattoos on his arms and neck, including Celtic bands. Now, we know he's interested in boxing and trains on a regular basis. So, where are they hiding tonight? Call us here in the studio if you know. The number's there on your screen, or you can text us on 63399. Just type crime, that space, and then your message. Don't forget to leave that space, or your message won't get through.
This is Irma Tati Rogers, Tati to her friends. Well, back in January, she disappeared from her home in Wrexham in North Wales. There has been no trace of her since. Indeed, what started out as a missing persons inquiry is now a murder investigation. I'm going to speak now to DI Mark Hughes and Tati's friend Deviani. Thanks for joining us, Deviani Jones. First of all, to you, Mark, it is almost a year on since this young woman disappeared. Why are you now treating it as a murder investigation?
Everything we know about Tati suggests that her disappearance is completely out of character. She had friends, she went to college, she was sending gifts home to her family, and there's just absolutely no reason for her to vanish.
Now, you and your team took some... It is very interesting in terms of what it tells us about what she was up to at the time of her disappearance. It's some footage from her flat around the time she disappeared.
Yes.
Let's just take a look at this. Here we are. And just take... I mean, it looks just like a normal flat, doesn't it? Like,
yes.
Like somebody living their life normally. What are we
yes.
seeing here?
Well, it's just a lived-in flat.
And here we go. Now, there's paperwork here. This is interesting, because we see some evidence there of what? That's one of these postal stickers.
Yeah, that's right. As I said, Tatty was regularly sending gifts home.
Right, OK. And this is her kitchen, and again, it just looks like... Now, this is the key in the kitchen. This is her evening meal.
That's right, yeah. We're aware that she bought some food early in the day
so
to
cook. OK, fridge is food.
Absolutely, yeah.
Her fridge is full.
Yes.
And also, the other things that you saw in the house that aren't on the film here, I mean, what other things gave you a clue that she was not planning to go anywhere?
Well, on the day that she disappeared, it was pouring with rain. All her outer clothing is there, and a coat, and money, a passport, everything is in the flat.
Okay. What do you know about what she got up to on the day she went missing?
We know that she went shopping in Summerfield in the afternoon. She bought her dinner.
There we are. We've got some CCTV
yeah,
of that there. That's her buying a day's shopping.
That's right. And that's the last footage that we have of Tatty alive.
And that was the sort of thing that she did every day. It was just, as far as she was concerned, as far as you know, just a normal day.
Yes, absolutely.
I said that Deviani was here. You're one of Tatty's good friends. Tell me a bit about her. What sort of person was she?
Well, Tatty's very friendly and reliable, trust. She's just very thoughtful, really, for people and everybody, very kind to everybody. And, it's unlike her to be missing.
It must be very upsetting to you and her other friends that
yes.
one day she was there, the next day she was not. What's it been like trying to deal with that?
It's very terrible to deal with it. We just don't believe it, what's been happening. I spoken with Tati's family, sister, her name is Emma, last week, and she said to me, it's everybody in Indonesia, all the family still very worried and upset over Tatty missing. And just hoping and thank you, that she also said thank you to the North Wales Police that for the whole all hard working. And would like to appeal to the public, if any information at all they have, please call the police.
So, Mark, I mean,
help.
Devastating to
oh,
her family
absolutely.
And friends, trying to deal with the lack of knowledge and wondering
yes.
what on earth has happened. There are two other very important things that you should tell us about concerning the investigation. One's the phone.
Yes, that's
that.
Right. We're very interested in finding her mobile phone, which is a Nokia 6100, which we know she was using on the day that she went missing. And obviously, we're interested if anybody's found one of those discarded in the Wrexham area.
The other thing is this extraordinary piece of luggage. Tell me about that.
Yeah, we're very interested to hear from anybody that's purchased one of these. We know there was a number bought from a store in Wrexham, TJ Hughes's, in January. I would appeal for anybody that has purchased one or have seen one discarded since.
OK. Mark, thank you very much. Deviani, a special thank you for you. And there is a £100,000 reward relating to the successful conclusion.
There is, yes.
And conviction in this case. Thanks very
thank
much.
You. Thank you.
It would be great, of course, if we could solve this. Well, it is a murder investigation now. If you can help, call or text us now. The number is right there on the screen. It's time now for a behind-the-scenes look at how detectives caught this man. His name is David Munley. He bludgeoned to death an 87-year-old. Her name was Jean Barnes. He then went to extraordinary lengths to cover his tracks. He very nearly got away with it, but was caught out thanks to his own handwriting. Matthew has been sifting through the extraordinary evidence.
This is the major crimes archive at Sussex Police. I'm surrounded by all the clues and evidence that helped police catch David Munley, a psychopath who killed an elderly woman and then fooled the outside world into thinking she was still alive. It was this note left for a milkman that finally led to his downfall.
His victim was 87-year-old Jean Barnes. She lived on her own in Worthing in West Sussex.
Jean Barnes was educated at Cambridge. She was one of the first women to go to Cambridge, and she spoke six languages. However, in later life, she lived quite a reclusive lifestyle.
When she hadn't been seen for a couple of weeks, a concerned neighbour called police. When they got into the house, they made a grim discovery. She'd been murdered and covered up with a blanket, and her body had been lying there for around 2 weeks.
At that stage, what did you have to actually go on?
Very little. Looking around the house, she'd obviously lived alone for some time. There were newspapers stacked up everywhere. But also, there were marks in the dust where objects must have been in the past, and now they were missing. It would appear that someone after the murder had stolen some property from the house.
Then new clues began to emerge, pointing to a sinister and determined attacker, someone who'd been preying on Jean Barnes for quite some time.
What we discovered in those early days of the investigation was that she had made contact with the police on a number of occasions, in particular in February, when she was putting out some milk bottles and she was attacked on her doorstep. She managed to fight them off and closed the door and contacted the police. In the April, she received a phone call from somebody purporting to be from the bank. They started to ask her personal questions, name, date of birth. But during that conversation, Miss Barnes became suspicious, so she contacted the bank and the police.
Was this, in fact, her killer?
Then a vital clue was discovered that was to change the course of the investigation. A note for the milkman left on Jean Barnes's doorstep.
The note told the milkman to cancel further deliveries as she was going into a nursing home.
That seemed plausible enough, but for one crucial fact. Detectives knew that Jean Barnes couldn't have written it. By the time it was left on her doorstep, she was already dead.
The milkman's note was compared to samples of Jean Barnes's handwriting found in the house. The conclusion? It was written by somebody else.
As police delved deeper, they uncovered more things that simply didn't make any sense.
Jean's bills had been paid with a forged cheque. Someone had even taken in her post and newspapers.
In fact, somebody had gone to extraordinary lengths to fool everyone into thinking that Jean Barnes was still alive and well. But why?
Police needed a new lead. What sort of person could do this? They enlisted the help of a psychological profiler to try to get inside the mind of the killer.
I was in no doubt in my own mind that we were dealing with someone who was dangerously a psychopath. A psychopath is an individual that does not have conscience or guilt. They would have needed to have returned to the house and had the capacity to walk past Miss Barnes and what they had done to her, and still return to pick up her belongings. It, to most people, would be breathtakingly callous to the psychopath. They wouldn't have any concern or compunction whatsoever. She's lived her life, I'm going to have those possessions, end of.
So, police knew they were looking for a psychopath. They even knew what his handwriting looked like, but they didn't know his name. So they turned to Crimewatch.
Going on Crime Watch was a long shot. We had the handwriting, which we knew did not belong to Miss Barnes, and we wanted to know who it did belong to.
Against all the odds, police did get the call they were hoping for. A woman in Worthing recognised the handwriting and named David Munley, an odd-job man who lived half a mile from Jean Barnes. The woman who called Crime Watch told how Munley had done work for her and her neighbour. He'd stolen a chequebook and forged signatures. It was all sounding rather familiar.
Munley was arrested. He insisted he was innocent. But when samples of his handwriting were analysed, they gave him away.
That handwriting matched exactly the writing on the notes to the milkman and the writing on the cheques.
Police then discovered what Munley had done with Jean Barnes's antiques. He'd been selling them to small shops like this one in Worthing. Over the months, the owner got to know him quite well.
How often had he been coming in and what had he said to you?
He'd been in on a regular basis. We used to chat about everything, really, from, you know, from the army through to where all the stuff was coming from, which was East Anglia. It was an aunt of his who'd passed away, and he was clearing the house out.
And you were never suspicious? I mean, what was he like?
He was a very amiable chap, very likeable, very laid back. I got on very well with him. It just goes to show you never know somebody that well. And to say that I was shocked was an understatement, a real understatement.
Sure enough, when police checked the antiques supplied by Munley, they'd been stolen from Jean Barnes.
Police now had the final piece of the jigsaw and were able to put together what actually happened.
We believe that David Munley was stealing from Miss Barnes in the run-up to her murder. She had noticed things going missing and improved her security.
But somehow, Munley had found a way in.
Who are you? What are you doing here? Get out of my house!
He beat her around the head 9 times. Left her dead downstairs. Covered her body with a blanket and continued to steal from the house.
The final piece of compelling evidence was found when they searched his house. This is police footage of the actual moment when they found Jean Barnes' identity card hidden under the stairs.
And there it is.
It was a conclusive link between Munley and his victim.
In police interviews, Munley denied everything.
Did you kill Jean Barnes?
No.
Are you certain?
Yes. Notes were left for a milkman following Jean's death. Did you write those notes?
No. Different people have given us different versions than you've given in the last couple of days. Why's that?
They're all against mine. Simple as that.
I think you're lying.
That's your prerogative. I think they're lying.
Police charged Munley with the murder of Jean Barnes on the 4th of December, 1999.
I did not murder Jean Barnes.
I would describe David Munley as all things that a psychopath is, devoid of conscience, totally focused on the end game as far as it suits him, without any concern in any regard for anybody along the way.
Miss Barnes was an 87-year-old woman. She'd led a wonderful life. Nobody had the right to take that life from her. And I'm very pleased we were able to capture David Munley and convict him for her murder.
Calculating, calm and cold, you could describe this bloke as. I think it's, you know, often when we talk, Matthew, we talk about all the forensic evidence and new technology. It wasn't about that this time around. It was really about the handwriting.
Yes, it was absolutely critical in this case. And it's a fascinating area of science. When the handwriting experts look at things like this, they examine everything about the handwriting, the shape of the letters, the proportion, the construction of the sentences, the words chosen, even under the microscope, the way a pen has moved across the paper, that can give them vital clues. And it's pretty exact as well. The Forensic Science Service say handwriting and fingerprints are the only two areas of forensic evidence that can convict somebody on its own. Even DNA needs supporting evidence. So if they find a match, it's pretty conclusive.
How extraordinary. What about Jean Barnes herself? There was a clue in your film that actually here was a woman who, she came to a terrible end, but had had a rather fascinating and rich life in her early years, certainly.
She was extraordinary. I mean, towards the end of her life, she had withdrawn from the outside world, but in her heyday, she was one of the first women to graduate from Cambridge. She could speak 6 languages, she had a photographic memory, she worked during the war for the Foreign Office. I mean, she was quite something.
We hear the word psychopath bandied about all the time in reports about people who've done terrible things. Actually, it's quite a technical term and it nails this man completely.
It really does. Munley was a classic psychopath. A few clues from his background. He was separated from his wife. He had 10 brothers and sisters whom he never saw. He was a bit of a gambler, a bit of a loner, but it's that inability to form any sort of long-term human relationships. That's a telltale sign. So too, what they picked up on in those interviews. Absolutely callous, no remorse, totally cold, no human emotions at all. And it's worth just saying, we've done a longer interview with an expert in this area just to give people an insight into the mindset of a psychopath, and that's available on the Crimewatch website.
Thanks, Matthew. Now here's Rav with what's coming in on the phones.
Already got some good stuff coming in. Just minutes old, the case of Ricardo Cox, the innocent guy in the wrong place at the wrong time who was tragically murdered. Calls are coming in with some information on the possible weapon believed involved, which is good. We showed you the Bebington armed robbery series. The series of suspects, we've got some good information where they may well be hiding tonight. And also, more importantly perhaps, some calls on the main guy that we showed you. I think we've got his still now, where he may well be. And we've got some good names for him that the police are following up.
Now, just time to tell you about Crimewatch Solved, a special coming up in January. We tell the story of three incredible cases and how detectives solve them. They include the Black Widow. This is her, a woman called Dina Thompson. Now, she used sex and deception to con hundreds of thousands of pounds from a string of husbands and lovers. And when her web of lies unravelled, well, her solution was murder. We've also got the story of a gang who planned the biggest gold heist in British history, and the man who murdered a young woman. Her body was dismembered and never found. It was solved thanks to a chilling poem written by the killer. Here's a sneak preview.
You heard him! Open the door!
This would have dwarfed the Great Train Robbery and the Brinksmack Robbery put together.
It was as if it was something he was reenacting from a horror film he had watched.
Well, that's Crimewatch Solved on Tuesday, the 6th of January at 9 o'clock here on BBC One.
Well, worth a watch. That's all for now. Details on all of tonight's cases are online, bbc.co.uk/Crimewatch. You can log on now for a live update on what's been happening right here in the studio on the phone. It's been a busy night. The lines are open until midnight tonight and from 7:30 in the morning. Our next programme, well, that's on Tuesday, the 27th of January. But don't go away, because we are back after the news with a full update on all of tonight's cases. If you can help, but you haven't called in yet, please do it now. It could all be down to you. I'll see you at 10:35 for now. Bye-bye.
Tonight's Newsnight, three British soldiers tell us in their own words about fighting on the front line in Iraq and Afghanistan. What does it mean to fight for your country and then to return home to people who may neither understand nor care why you did it? That's back from the front on tonight's Newsnight.
So few of us left. Every new person feels like a gift.
Do you ever think it might have been better not to have survived the virus?
Not for a second.
Watch all the episodes so far online now. BBC iPlayer, making the unmissable unmissable.
The BBC News now on BBC One with Hugh Edwards and Riz Latif.
Tonight at 10, another blow to the banks. This time they're victims of massive financial fraud.